Who's going to be brave enough this morning I lost Karen and my water, so I'm in trouble. Who's going to be brave enough this morning to speak the Greek for the series that we have been working through? It's in your bulletin, I think. It's in the bulletin?
It is.
It is? Oh, okay. I was corrected. Okay, who's going to speak it, not read it outright? Who's going to read it and pronounce it? Te basileia tou theou. And it means what? Come on, wake up. We are going to get words out of you sooner or later. It lets me know that you are hearing me. That's an important part of preaching. So, Te basileia tou theou means what? The kingdom of God. And we've been talking about the kingdom of God, and I'm going to move through the first section, hopefully very, very quickly, just as a reminder, reminding you that we spoke the first Sunday about an alternative reality that Jesus that God intended through Jesus Christ as the reality that his followers would choose. And the expression of that alternative reality in Acts, in the apostolic church, was a form of communism, a form of leveling the playing field. So the Bible can tell us that in that community where they were, no one was in want. I talked about that in terms of that was particularly in that community. And it may not be particularly what God calls us to today. In fact, I would insist that what the church has done in its wisdom has held that was probably an unsustainable reality and reduced the notion of giving all things in common to going back to the sense of the tithe in the Old Testament. So that the church is understood, the tithe then, to be the expression carried forward from the apostolic community all across the ages by the Church of Jesus Christ as an attempt to level the playing field, as an attempt to make sure there's no one in want in the community where the faithful church is actually serving. Unfortunately, the modern expression of that tithe is about 1% to 3%. We know that across the board, that we haven't even heard or paid attention to the wisdom of the historic church. And we might want to go back and revisit that as we understand that the apostolic church and the church across history has understood that part of living into the kingdom is living in the kingdom in a way that really does make sure that no one in community is in want. Second, we talked about Jesus as the visible evidence that God's kingdom is present. And I'm not going to say a whole lot about that other than to remind us that when we go to the scriptures, when we go to the gospel particularly, that we might understand that the miracles performed by Jesus are the evidences of the active spirit of the divine God, meaning that the abode of the divine God has been moved from far off to present. It is here, it is a reality amongst us that we can, thank you, Gary, thank you, we can choose to be a part of or not, because we looked at the difference between understanding, and I'm going to talk about that a little bit more, and actually living into. We talked last week about the basic characteristics of the kingdom of God, and they are formed by what Jesus called essentially the law and the prophets, gathered everything up into these, and that was to love God with everything you have, to love God and self with everything you have, so that you might actually be able to love people in the world with everything that you have. And therefore, living into the kingdom, excuse me, the notion of living into the kingdom arises from the basic position of agape love. And if there, excuse me, And if there is a point that I think we need to take a little bit more seriously, is we need to pay a little bit more attention to what is the basis of our relationship to God and to neighbor. This probably, we could probably talk about this every Sunday of the year and still not get it right, because it requires out of us serious energy. It requires out of us a serious intentionality, because remember, agape love is not something, it's not falling in love. It's not what we equate with love at all. It is a rational decision to do what Jesus said you are to do if you are my follower. It's that cold. It's that sharp. It's that much in your face. And so it is, if we are not there, it is not because of our neighbor is particularly difficult, or we've had difficult situations or whatever. It's because we have chosen in some fashion, maybe not way up in the conscious mind, but in the subconscious mind, we have chosen to not pay attention so much to the notion of a love of God. But last week, when we talked about all of these things, talked about there is a very big difference between understanding, hearing this and understanding it, and actually putting it into practice. It's in theological circles, this is talked about in terms of official theology and functional theology. It's talked about in terms of what we say we are, in terms of what the Gospels tell us, and how we actually live that out in life. And very often, there is a great big divide between our official theology, who we say we are, and our functional theology, how we live that out. And so I want to talk about that, the kingdom of God lived out in the world. What does it mean to live out the kingdom of God in the world? And I want to move then to Paul, who spends a lot of time in all of his writings trying to, in essence, define for us what it means to live out the kingdom of God in this world. For the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating and drinking. Now, I want you to know this. I am absolutely aware that the passage that I'm reading is in the larger context of Paul, where people have come to him and they are talking about, can we eat food that has been sacrificed to idols? Because in the time of Paul, there was not what we have today in terms of people who take animals and prepare them so that we have food to put on our tables. All of the animals that were killed in that day were killed as a sacrificial rite to one of the pagan gods in the place where Paul lived and moved and had his being. And so I want you to know that's the larger context of the particular precope that I'm looking at this morning. For the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating and drinking, but of righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. That is particularly what I want to address. Because anyone who serves Christ in this way is pleasing to God and approved by men. Let us therefore make every effort to do what leads to peace and to mutual edification. And very importantly, this last sentence, do not destroy the work of God for the sake of food. The first thing that Paul talks about here is righteousness. When he talks about being pleasing to the divine God, he lifts up this word righteousness, which we talk about a lot, and it's, I think oftentimes we make terrible assumptions about people understanding that. Righteousness is a pretty broad term. Righteousness, first of all, implies this, right thinking. If we are not able to right think, to think rightly, if we are not able to think in line with the Lord Jesus Christ, we might have been given the gift of eternal life. I believe that if we confess Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, our salvation is secure. But that's only one segment of the truth that has given to us. Paul says that the person who has received the gift of eternal life will, as acts of thanksgiving, live into righteousness, right thinking, thinking about the world in terms of how the Lord Jesus Christ thinks about the world. And it doesn't take a scholar to see that. Again, if we pay more attention to the Gospels of the Lord Jesus Christ, we will understand and see how he thought. And this is a basic truth about Jesus Christ. He always thought out of that pool of incredible love. Amen? It was the thing. It was the basis for what he thought about. And we can see what he thought about by the second aspect of righteousness. That is right action. You cannot separate it off. You cannot call yourself a righteous person because of a thought pattern solely. You might have a thought pattern right, but that's official theology. But if it's not lived into, a functional theology suggests that we don't understand the call of the Lord Jesus Christ into the kingdom of Almighty God at all. Because right thought requires right action. I know I should move into the world and put my hands to the task. I think this is where what I was trying to say about the missions team. I know I should do it. I know I should do it. I know I should do it. I'm going to get a ticket to go watch the Baltimore Orioles. I didn't want to pick on the Phillies. They're bad enough right now. I want to pick on... Oh, come on. Chase. But right action requires us to put our being, love the Lord your God with your strength, to put our very being on the front line. But also, very, very importantly for Paul, is that he talks about acts of justice. That if we are to live into the kingdom, then we have got to be concerned about issues of justice. And not for me, but issues of justice for those who have no voice. No one is speaking for them. Secondly, Paul talks about peace. And listen again to this. Most notably, peace that Paul's talking about is internal peace in the faith community. But listen, I don't have to say much about this. I'm not going to. We all know that church after church after church after church does not have peace within internal in the community. We know of fights, and we know of divisions, and we know of splits because people in the Church of Jesus Christ don't even have that kind of peace in the Lord Jesus Christ so that we can actually live with one another who we might have differences of opinion. Do not destroy the work of God for the sake of food. Now, that's why I want to say again, I understand that this precope is in the larger context of the issues of can I eat food or not. And Paul talks about this. He says, you know what, if your faith is strong and you can eat that food, go ahead, because we know those gods don't exist. But he says to them, but if you are with a weaker brother in the faith that sees that meat and believes there are other gods and it will offend them, then your job is to not eat meat. The spiritually healthy one is to be the one to make that decision. And oh, by the way, don't look down on your brother who has weaker faith. If your faith is stronger, then you should be that which is helping him grow in his faith, not that which is looking down your nose at your brother or your sister. But in its most basic sense, it says don't destroy the work of God over something stupid. You get that, right? And listen, how many times have you seen the faith of someone destroyed over something stupid? Or a church split over something stupid? Or being upset and realizing, because it's probably happened to all at one time or another, and realizing that, man, I was mad at my brother in Christ over something stupid. Paul tells us this, and it's one of the key. Probably for Paul, it's the basic issue. that if you are living into the kingdom of God, there will be unity in the community of Christ. There is no division where the kingdom of God is present. It's another issue that we don't understand very well, especially in the age in which we live, where personal opinion has been raised to the level of God, so that we can have different opinions over a subject and then get mad over something stupid. And Paul says this: where there is disunity, there is the evil one. Where there is unity, there is God. Very clear. It's no equivocation. And what he means by unity is not conformity. Because really, where various opinions arise, there's energy, there's a dynamic there that keeps us moving forward. But when it comes to its final degree, it calls us, one of us, to exercise a little bit of humility to allow perhaps at this time another person's opinion to arise so that we can follow that. And when that happens, it's not an issue of conformity, but it is an issue of unity, recognizing that all of us in here, according to Paul, have been gifted by the Holy Spirit. Amen? All of us have been touched by the Holy Spirit. And so Paul says this: how can you ever be in a spirit of disunity with another person who has received the gift of Almighty God? Watch out. Paul's serious on this. Watch out. When that happens, you are not in good communion with God himself. Lastly, and I'll only say a word about this, lastly is joy. Now, what Paul means by joy is this. Again, I want to mention the mission trip. What Paul means joy is this. It is joy. We are able to walk into the world filled with a sense of joy, even in the darkness and destruction that's going on, not because of my emotions, but because I know that when I am in unity, in the presence of the community of Christ, then I am where God wants me to be. And the joy that I receive is a joy that arises from the notion that I am right with God. And when I am right with God, it doesn't matter whether you agree with me or not. Now, you got to be careful, because this is where self-righteousness crops in. Because we can get to the point where we believe we're right when the rest of the community is saying, wait a minute, wait a minute. Remember, the joy in Jesus Christ requires that we also exercise, and I'll talk about this in a minute, a high level of humility before the divine God. Because no matter how right we feel we are we more pure and more right than God himself? Are we more perfect than the Lord Jesus Christ himself? If we are not, then we need to exercise that humility that will allow us to experience and express the joy of Almighty God in this world because of our knowledge that we are a part of the kingdom of God. How does the kingdom, how does one live out the kingdom life? Listen again to Paul, and this is moving to Romans, first part of chapter 12. Therefore, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. Do not be conformed and no longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. By the renewing of your mind. And for Paul, Paul talks about the renewing of your mind in this fashion, that if we are to renew our mind, first of all, we must pray to the divine God with the belief that the only way that my mind can be renewed in the Lord Jesus Christ is by prayer, is by God. We are to pray with that kind of fervent desire that God will be a part of that which is renewing my mind. And if our mind is not renewed, we can experience Christ and we can experience the Christ event. We can receive Christ in our life and we can backslide. Good old Methodist term. We can backslide. We can walk ourselves right out of the gift of eternal life. We can have experienced Christ 50 years ago, but now not be animated by that presence of the Holy Spirit ever again. Never finding a sense of excitement in the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. Never being a part of that. Never, ever, in essence, living into it. And Paul says part of that reason is that we have lacked humility in Jesus Christ. And lastly, and I really am going to move through this one quickly, in Romans, just following the precept 12:1-3, Paul talks about this. Everyone has been gifted. And it essentially, you can reduce it to this. And I would encourage you, you can even pull out your Bibles, look at it, verse 4 and forward. Paul says, okay, everybody's been gifted. Quit saying you're not. But if you've been gifted as a prophet, then what you're to do is do it. If you've been gifted in by service, then don't talk about it, but do it. If you've been gifted by teaching, don't talk about it, do it. If your gift is encouraging, quit talking about it, encourage. If your gift is giving money, then by golly, you should be involved in supporting the work of the Church of Jesus Christ. If your gift is leadership, quit trying to duck it, do it. If your gift is mercy, then do it. It's an interesting thing here. Paul implies then that the kingdom of God is not a static place. That the kingdom of God is not a place where we have this kind of effortless piety, but the kingdom of God is action. It is action all the time. It is action everywhere. It is living it out. Don't talk about it. Do it. The visible and present kingdom of God, and this is something that I think we haven't talked about enough, is that when Jesus was brought back to the heavenly divine presence, and the outpouring of the Spirit came upon us at Pentecost, then the church corporately was supposed to be the visible presence of the kingdom of God. When the outpouring of the Spirit, remember we talked about the Spirit, first of all, was poured out upon Jesus Christ. And he became the visible evidence of the presence of the divine God's abode with us. When he was brought up at Pentecost and the Spirit was poured out generally upon the church, we were to take that and we were to be that. The criticism is this. The criticism is that we have not been careful about living into an alternative reality, but by and large, we have allowed the world to determine who we are and how we act. And that if we are to regain and recapture this a little bit, then we will be more serious about how we interact with the marketplace. We will be a little bit more serious about that. We will make decisions about how we will live into the marketplace based on not does it make me feel good, not is everybody else doing it, not is that the way of the world, but is that what Christ calls me to? And it is a criticism from the world that either corporately or individually, we have not been strong enough on that point. And an example for us, and I really don't believe it is fully the example, might be the Amish community, which we don't understand, but we can understand this. The guiding principle of what they allow themselves to do, the guiding principle is how much interaction with the marketplace will they allow and how distinct from the marketplace do they want to be. And I believe this, that if we are to truly become the visible presence of the kingdom of God, we will be a little bit more careful ourselves how we will or will not interact in the marketplace.
Let's close with one verse of our hymn at the end, "Guide me, O thou great Jehovah." Just the first verse.